I'm saying that I have a more difficult task than the previous speaker because I have 5 minutes to react, improvising on their presentations. So I will make some comments that on points that were touched by, both by Sapo, Ocampo, and Lawrence, and basically based on Latin American experience. 30 years ago, in 1985, we were here in a research, one of the first research projects of WIDER, led by Jerry Heliner, which is here, and Lance Taylor, in which Ocampo participated as a young researcher, believe it, and also Nora Lustig and other researchers that I present now in this conference. At that time, we were discussing in this project the adjustment of Latin Americans to the debt crisis. It was the first international crisis, big, like the whole region entered into crisis in 1981 and 1982. It was the first crisis of the financial globalization process that were starting at that time, and so it was Lawrence commented, the reform of international system, if we can call it system or non-system, maybe better, was pushed by crisis, and this crisis, the Latin American debt crisis, pushed the IMF and the Fed to new roles in the management of this new type of crisis that were different than the current account crisis of the previous Bretton Woods system, and were basically capital account crisis for which the IMF didn't have enough resources to act as a lender or last resort if it wanted to do. But they didn't want it. But even though they haven't enough resources to. So the period, the 90s, was the period of the Washington Consensus in which the Latin American countries became highly in debt, and almost all the major countries of the region suffer financial and balance of payment crisis in the 90s, huge crisis like the Argentine crisis 2000 of 1995, the Mexican crisis of 1995, the Argentine crisis of 2001, another crisis, the Brazilian crisis of 1998. So there was first 30 years of financial of globalization were marked by a succession of crises in emerging market economies. In the 2000s, particularly between 2002-2003, after the Argentine, Uruguay, and Turkey crisis, they were the last crisis suffered by emerging market economies. Latin American countries perform much better. Well, everybody knows that in part it was the behavior was. Was the improvement in the behavior of this economy was helped by the improvement in the terms of trade, basically caused by the demand of commodities by the Chinese and Indian, but basically Chinese economy. And this, but it wasn't that only. It was that the countries learned from previous experience, and for instance, they flexibilized the exchange rate systems, the exchange rate regimes. For instance, all the crises that the developing economies suffered during the first 30 years of financial globalization were in situations in which the exchange rate were fixed or quasi-fixed or predetermined. So, and there was no other crisis after the 90s. In the 2000s, there were no new crises, even in the context of the American global financial crisis of 2007-2008. So there was not contagion to emerging market economy, which is a very interesting issue, and it in part has to be with this change in the exchange rate regimes, but also the Latin American countries, on average, up to 2008, had a relatively depreciated real exchange rate, experienced current account surpluses, except Colombia. The rest of Latin America, or South America, show current account surplus results, and accumulated, as was mentioned, accumulated reserve based on these surplus current account results, and capital inflows. But there's a problem there in the system, or the known system, that this is a system that lacks of any coordination of exchange rate policies or regimes, and lacks of a significant last resort lender. You know? And so even if Latin American countries did better during the 2000s, now when the countries are confronting the new situation of declining terms of trade and the immediate possibility of a rise in the international interest rate, the countries found themselves in a situation of very appreciated exchange rate, and with the need of they are experiencing huge devaluation that do not find in the economy any tradable sectors that could respond to the to the new stimuli generated by the depreciated, the presently more depreciating exchange rate, because they all serve, all these countries suffer Dutch disease. And the countries, while the IMF push in the end of the 90s, the flexibilization of exchange regimes, the doctrine of the institution is a pure floating exchange regime. The exchange inflation targeting, full-fledged inflation targeting, means for the IMF a pure floating exchange regime. But the countries didn't do that, but managed design, practice a flexible exchange regime, but managed exchange rate regimes that allow to central banks to intervene, to buy an intervention, and this was what the main source of accumulating reserves. But the interventions were very strong enough to accumulate substantial reserves in the cases of Brazil, Argentina, Peru, Colombia, less in Mexico and Chile, that were more orthodox in the sense that leave the exchange rate floating for more freely. But the interventions were not intended to stop the appreciation trend that the countries were suffering as from the beginning, the 2003-2004. So now, this appreciation trend caused a deindustrialization at Dutch disease. The IMF has a role. Played a role in these performances of the Latin American economies, because the IMF always, the idea of the IMF was, well, we don't know which the equilibrium exchange rate is. Let the market define the equilibrium. What the equilibrium? 1 minute, please. The equilibrium exchange rate, and really, if we don't know what the equilibrium exchange rate is, a prudent attitude towards monetary policy would have been to preserve some stability of the real exchange rate in order to avoid what is going on now, which is huge devaluations that impact inflation and generate recessionary trends without finding, because of previous Dutch disease, tradable sectors that could react to the new stimuli generated by the now more depreciated exchange rate. Well, let's continue in the debate.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Roberto, for bringing us back from the stratosphere of international financial to the realities of actually managing these economies. And it was very, 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 very useful to know. So perhaps we should have real exchange rate coordination, not just the nominal ones, perhaps. Anyway, you're now going to talk to us about the African perspective on this.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I'm happy to be here. But of course, I only have 10 minutes to say. Is it five? Oh, when did you change the base? Oh, sorry. Okay, fantastic.
They're all given five and take 10.
So oh, you took 10. So, yeah, I'll take 15.
No.
Because I've come from further away. Anyway, thank you very much, and I'm happy to be here. And of course, sitting here and talking about this issue is always very difficult for me. I've just finished my two terms in the Central Bank of Kenya. 8 years of public service has been quite devastating for me. I'm trying to decompress down. But the most important thing is that some of the issues that have been raised here are very, very pertinent, and they are very, very true. But let me make 4 points. First, I just want, from where I was sitting, I've been sitting, and what I've been observing is that domestic financial systems in Africa and even emerging markets have improved. The regulatory capacity and even regulatory technology has improved. And for the last few years, we have seen that even the standard setting bodies have really improved. So not only have we improved domestic capacity for regulation, we have improved the regulatory technology, but also we have recent, and we have seen what these standard setting bodies like Financial Action Task Force or even Basel have done. And of course, that is the point. We're making that point so that I can come to perhaps Lauren's point about what do we need in terms of reforms, because essentially we are not really saying that that technology is actually going to help. We talk about so many things in terms of improving the domestic financial system. Of course, too big to fail banks has been quite a big problem. But the most important thing is that we have seen those results. They are quite commendable. The second point, of course, when you're talking about that, we also have to talk about what has happened in the last few years, in the couple of years, especially the 30 years, that emerging markets, emerging economies, and even developing economies have actually managed to access international markets, international financial markets. And for us, this is very important. You can see that in the financial crisis 2008, most countries actually survived because they had accumulated adequate reserves. But that doesn't mean that the demand for reserves is actually really has helped them. But of course, the most important thing is that those countries realize that reserves are going to help them in terms of accessibility of reserves, and even saving those reserves are going to help the domestic market. But of course, you can see the turnaround in terms of reserves themselves and reserves management and reserve currencies, what has happened to especially African countries. First, you can see that as we talk today, since 2008, it's actually like we pay to maintain those reserves. Of course, we made our own regulations about you have to invest those reserves in AAA institutions, and those AAA institutions were only to be found mostly in developing countries. But right now, you can see that it's like we pay to keep those reserves in those countries. So you can see that all of a sudden it was a precious bane, then all of a sudden it's turning out to be quite a difficult aspect. So essentially, when you talk about international architectural reforms, it's actually important to look at that, because we still think that reserves are very, very important to cushion the markets, because let's talk about capital accounts liberalization, we still think that we need to cushion this nascent market. The third point I wanted to talk about is actually development financing. These are interesting aspects, but there are two dimensions to it. One of them is development financing institutions themselves and how they are structured. And the other one is actually access to capital, international development capital. And you can see the wave in Africa, while most of the countries have realized that they can go for sovereign bonds to help roll out public investments, especially to close the infrastructure gap. That is good, but of course, it means that you also have to understand that you have to deal with, that's the third point, fourth point I was making, what happens to the future currency and even reserve currencies themselves, because essentially, that development finance, accessibility to that development finance, accessibility to those resources, is going to depend very much in terms of how the reserve currencies behave. Most of the instability we have seen since 2008 has actually been currencies themselves. stability of the currencies themselves, because we are hooked to the currencies, and obviously when there is a big fight between the dollar and the euro, obviously you can see what happens in terms of those markets agents lashing for dollar denominated assets and vice versa. So essentially, that is where most of the instability is coming up. So even when we talk about the instability of the financial system, we have to come back and ask ourselves, actually, what are the spillovers in developing countries? And even including their, even if you start talking about even their monetary policy stance, how are they going to survive in terms of that kind of, most countries in Africa obviously have independent monetary policy, driven by the fact that, of course, they have floating currencies. But you can see what kind of pitfalls that we have. And also, that moves back into even the stability of currencies driven by also capital flows. We liberalize the capital accounts. But essentially, most of the time, you find that we attract portfolio flows. And portfolio flows will always, in necessity, move the nominal exchange rates. And the nominal exchange rates, our politicians react very viciously when currencies are depreciating. They tend to have this belief that currencies should actually appreciate, never depreciate. But of course, there's also a real threat, because currency depreciation also feeds into domestic inflation. Obviously, when there are supply constraints, because if you have to import food, like I come from the north of the Horn of Africa, where devastating droughts would affect not only food prices, but also energy prices at the same time. Then you can see what it means when there's a currency depreciation. It's just going to feed straight into inflation. So these are three real threats to domestic financial systems and even monetary policy making. But finally, let me, of course, go back to the issue of, we all talk about financial system, domestic financial system. We look at international financial system. But most of the time, we don't make a difference in terms of actually who participates in these financial systems from where we come from, developing countries, especially in Africa. And you'll find that for many years, they were driven by multinational corporates and multinational banks. And then it is all of a sudden, the last perhaps, let me say, 10 years, that we find that domestic financial systems are coming up. They were very inaccessible. There were so many barriers to entry. So all of a sudden, in the last 10 years, we've realized that we can actually create an environment where domestic financial systems can also improve and thrive. And of course, I've been accused myself that I've been promoting banks in Kenya, and they have covered the region, which was good to do. And I argued that I promoted strong banks, domestic banks in Kenya, to become strong banks to serve the East African region. I did not want to promote big banks because we don't have the technology to regulate big banks. Those are the too big to fail banks. No, we didn't have that. And that has become very important. It has become very important because all of a sudden, accessibility of markets has created strong banks. Strong banks have realized that they have capacity to serve in future. But the most important thing is what actually happens when you look at the totality of the international financial architecture. We have popularize that you can actually have banks, thank you, that we can actually create strong banks at the financial system who are actually allowing domestic investors, private investors to participate in those markets. We do agree, and we know that markets are very thin, but they're also pivoted by, of course, all the issues that have been talked about here. We can talk about from the point of view of the lingering debt overhang problems that may arise because African governments are going, contracting sovereign bonds. Of course, some of them are doing fine because they are rolling out huge infrastructure projects that are reducing transactions cost immensely and creating complementarity to private investment and even enhancing profitability of private investors because of transactions cost. But that's one side of it. One of them is how would they be paid? Some of them are actually relying very much on the future flows of natural resources. Of course, that's bad because actually you're losing forward contracts. But the most important thing is that so many things have changed. They are complementary to the kind of changes the kind of reforms that I've listened to Roland's talking about in terms of international financial system and how we view the regulatory structures in our own domestic economy. And they have to be ascribed to international financial systems. For example, we'll find that the typical IMF program in African countries is actually to give you balance of payment support. And you believe that that's going to be the most critical thing because you liberalized your capital markets, but you have not been able to attract capital FDI. What you attract is actually portfolio flows, but you're going to get then sporadic shocks that you can't be cushioned. So essentially, you refuse to deal with the real disease. You want to be dealing with the symptoms as they come. And that is why we would like to perhaps discuss these issues in terms of reforms. Thank you very much.
Very much indeed. I thought it was very percipient, particularly this new phenomenon, in a sense, of an emerging banking system in Africa with a capacity for transnational banking, which I think is very interesting. In the trade session, I would like to start at least by inviting questions from people under a certain age, without specifying it, because people got very upset when I said 40 yesterday, and then people said, I'm 41, can I speak? So you know perfectly well what I mean. So can we have firstly a round of questions from people who are not quite so mature, and then we'll have the mature ones afterward. You'd like to start us off?
Thank you. Do you understand?
Need to say who you are and where you're from.
Okay. Alyssa DiCaprio from Asian Development Bank. And I actually have a question about regulation of the international financial system. Now, one problem that we're facing right now is when you talk about the regulation of banks, right? And specifically, I'm thinking here of AML and KYC. Because, you know, it's important what it's supposed to be doing, which is restricting terrorism financing, right, and money laundering. However, it's overregulated, and what we're finding is that there's de-risking from the major banks in our poorest markets. So what we found is our banks are pulling out of the markets where it's most risky. We recently did a survey, actually, and we found out that 45% of our banks have canceled correspondent relationships with their banks in developing countries. 30% of those canceled relationships, there were no findings of non-compliance. There wasn't even suspicion of non-compliance. It was just that, it's kind of expensive to do it, and so it's kind of a high-risk market. It's not really a high return. Let's pull out. So my question is, how much regulation is too much? Clearly, this is not good for our developing countries. But do we continue on this vein?
Excellent question. Of the overlap of regulatory structures, any other questions from? No? No? Well, shall we take the, Rob? You claim to be represent the youth vote, do you? Okay. Well, just
pretend. Rob Postov, FEO. Bellevue started the discussion saying, "Well, that the lots of financial reforms have been promised, and then we don't get them." In that context, also, if we look forward to the new development agenda. It's very disappointing also to see that none of the issues that were discussed here were really discussed at the Financing for Development Conference in Addis Ababa, that is, was to provide the financial support backing of the new agenda. So apparently these issues are not there. Now, so the question is then what we could do to move forward. And in that sense, I had a question to José Antonio when you said, provide the development links to the reserve system and use SDRs or not use SDRs, and you sort of argue against the fiscal use of SDRs. I can see the arguments for it. But at the same time, what we see in practice is that those countries have taken a lot of self-insurance and built up the reserves probably in much larger quantities than they ever need. And now we're seeing that they can make better use of those reserves by putting them into sovereign wealth funds as well as in BRICS banks and the Asian Infrastructure Bank and so on. So in a way, that is using your monetary reserves and then putting them to use for fiscal purposes in the end of the day if they finance the long-term development. So how would you see it also in connection with the SDR? Because there's a lot of excess SDRs also piled up in the IMF. Which could be used also for this purpose, either I'm not sure whether the fiscal use you mean in terms of direct use, or you mean also in terms of using it to leverage long-term financing through the development bank.
Would you like to No, well, my if you invest your reserves or some other financial asset into a multilateral development bank, I consider that to be a financial use. So you change one form of asset by, you know, for another form of asset, financial asset. So I think that's fine. So that's why one of my proposals is to allow the excess of SDRs to be invested in bonds of multilateral development banks, of any kind, let's say. What I disagree with is the idea that you can actually, you know, for example, developed countries have SDRs and they give them as ODA or as climate finance, as, you know, to finance climate change programs. I think that is a fiscal use of a financial asset. By the way, Strauss-Kahn was caught by surprise with the comment he made at one point in one of the World Economic Forum of using SDRs for that purpose, for climate change financing. He had to ask some of the technicians of the IMF to explain exactly what he meant. And actually, they produced a very interesting paper in which they actually made a financial use of the excess SDRs to subscribe the capital of climate change funds. So that's a financial use. And that paper is actually a quite nice paper. So that's my point, that use it financially, don't use it to spend.
Very firm views on this. I mean, clearly the international, especially global regulation, is still evolving. The Basel, for example, on the banks and so forth. So, I don't have a very firm view at the moment on what these issues. But clearly, there could be. There are very different kinds of agents in this operating and companies operating. So there could be cases of over-regulation as well. But this thing is still evolving, so it's very difficult to take a stand on that.
Yes, I think let's face it. I think KYC has been used, and sometimes it can also be used to overkill the process. And I have defended Kenya in Financial Action Task Force plenary, when we talk about KYC because we want to improve the AML-CFT regime. And my argument has been, look, financial exclusion is more dangerous for AML-CFT regime. Financial inclusion is much better. So essentially, when we come to financial inclusion, then you have to ask yourselves, how much leverage do we have in terms of KYC? What kind of, and Kenya is known for mobile phone financial services. And the question was, what kind of KYC do you put in place? And what we have done is use a risk-based approach in terms of proportionality of the risk that is faced, and we have ceilings in terms of how much you can transact. And we have explained this consistently and very well. And we have seen that it works very well, because even the technological platform where KYC the identification is already installed can be verified with ease. So you are right that sometimes KYC, and even now, the mobile phone financial services was just an entry point in terms of payment system, and it solved a great deal of transactions costs for people who could not access banks. And we want now to overkill it. So I had to defend it very, very strongly, because I argued that these are transactions, and these transactions have ceilings. And if you break the ceiling, you have now to provide more information. It's a tiered approach that We have actually even written some papers to show and to justify this. But in some cases, for example, you can see the fight between Barclays Bank and Dahab Shield is that we are actually trying to overkill because of this fear of AML-CFT regime. So you are right about that. But I think our advice has been, let's go to a risk-based approach. And in that process, we can have a tiered process in terms of the proportionality of the risk. And we have succeeded in Kenya to do that. And we have now introduced some of those aspects in the East African region.
Thank you very much. As I said before, we have time for a second round of comments. And given that Jerry Helina is here and started off the contribution of WIDER to these issues, I wonder whether you, Jerry, have any thoughts on looking back and looking forward.
Thank you. I may be the most mature here. A couple of questions for Jose Antonio. I was struck in your discussion of sources of liquidity and crisis finance by the absence of any reference to the Fed, which provided crisis finance, continues to provide crisis finance in amounts far larger than anything the IMF has been capable of doing. So there has to be some thought about how one moves from the system that we have, in which, in fact, the US Fed provides crisis finance, to the one which you describe as desirable. I don't know how you move from one to the other. The second question is for Seppo Hankapoja. I would be inclined to be a little more positive about capital liberalization, capital account liberalization. You expressed a desire for caution, and certainly perhaps that's appropriate. But even the IMF now concedes that it can be a capital account policy, can be a conscious macroeconomic policy instrument. For capital inflow as well as outflow, it can be deployed as just another macro instrument. And I'm not sure why you were as cautious as you were about that. One last thing for Lawrence. I like all the suggestions that you end up with. They don't seem to be emanating from the toolkit or the absence of a toolkit. Isn't the management of the real exchange rate, or Roberto was suggesting that efforts to stabilize movements in the real exchange rate, isn't that a tool in the toolkit which was not available in an earlier period and is now deployed regularly for better or worse? It's a powerful one.
Thank you very much, Jerry. Professor Singh, I think you had some thoughts for us.
I think yeah. You lack of time, but let me answer Jerry's question. A lot of what I was saying was...
Oh, good. Excellent. Fine. Okay. Well, it's very self-denying. It's unique. People actually give up their chance to speak. But did you have something quick, Machika? Yeah? As quickly as you can.
I mean, basically, cross-border flows, particularly to emerging market economy and the developing economies, is driven by global liquidity cycle, and that global liquidity cycle is driven by monetary policy in developed countries, and particularly US, and that links to question which Jose Antonio mentioned, dilemma, and we are living in a very fragile one. And now, I mean, even after 2007-08, cross-border flows is increasing from bank lending to bond instrument moved, but the fragility is still continuing in the system. And what happening from developing countries' point of view, because of this driven cross-border flows, push and pull is all driven by monetary policy in developed countries. At the same time, developing countries are losing policy instrument for the managing exchange rate or managing monetary stability. So we are living in imperfect world, and that linked to question to Lawrence, that you are schematic saying that we are fighting IFIs, IFC, one is fighting last war or last battle fire, and there is a endogeneity in private sector keep moving with the innovation, but 2007-08 crisis shows that the private sector cannot themselves, you know, go beyond that innovation. They needed public money, big money, to get the house in place. So I think there is a time, high time now for us to really think, even from private sector's point, there is a now to face that it is imperfect world, and we have to move reserve system from US dominated so-called exorbitant whatever privilege for US. Because US themselves cannot deal now domestic monetary policies, like yesterday it said, because of global financial situations, China factors, they couldn't do monetary policy. So there is now coming to the stage that time is ripe for private and the public sector's point of view, something we get serious about changing reserve system, as Antonio Jose said.
Well, thank you very much. That was an interesting and challenging idea. Well, I think if you can each respond in your own fashion to those two points and also use that as your concluding remarks, it would be helpful. So if you could like to start from the left, symbolically, or the right, depending if you look at it that way, as Jose Antonio. if you could all just answer briefly to these points and close.
Yeah. First of all, to Jerry's comment, it's perfectly right. Actually, my analysis of crisis management, I take a look very closely at the issue of the role of the Fed. Actually, you can go back to the 1960s because the swap amongst major central bank has been a system used at least since the 1960s. But in recent years, yes, it is the Fed, and the amount of financing by the Fed exceeds by several times what the IMF lends. However, it is concentrated in developed country central banks, and particularly in the European Central Bank. So the swaps with the European Central Bank are by far the most important. The emerging economies only had a temporary financing. The program that was agreed in or launched by the Fed in 2009, that included Singapore,
Indonesia.
Mexico. It was Korea. It was Singapore, Korea, Mexico, and Brazil. Those four countries. But that only lasted 1 year. It was not renewed, and the amounts were very small relative to the amounts of the Fed operations with the rest. On the question, I really think, well, I didn't have time, but one of the issues that I think has to be brought back into the agenda is the issue of cross-border capital and where the cross-border capital flows should have some form of regulation. I mean, the IMF went in the positive direction during this crisis, when it accepted the principle that regulating cross-border capital under some conditions is a legitimate thing to do. Well, it's actually a positive thing to do, because legitimacy has always been, by the way, because when Michel Candessou failed in 1997 in Hong Kong to impose capital account convertibility, it failed. So I think it should. But by the way, let me say that there is all, there has always been a schizophrenia in orthodoxy in the view of exchange rates in this way. The way I express it in my national debate in my country is that, you know, we have a very schizophrenic system. You know, we said free trade is the way to go, so export-oriented economy, okay? And then we give to export the most unstable price, the exchange rate. It's very schizophrenic. And by the way, it's very schizophrenic also at the global level. So there are two solutions to this. The European solution, which was then, you know, moving to one currency, eliminate exchange rates. That's one, you know, extreme. And the other is let the exchange rate float as, you know, as much as possible. You know, so that reminds me of the, you know, when I was a student, I had to read this at the time with the controversy on fixed exchange rate versus floating exchange rates. And floating exchange rates, we of course read Milton Friedman, okay? And on fixed exchange rates, we, my mind goes, anyway, the I remember this very, very close sentence, very, very clear sentence that, that a floating exchange rate is a tax on international trade. Okay? Which I think is perfectly correct. So we want free trade, and at the same time, we, you know, give free trade the most stable prices. So it's a, so there are two schizophrenic solutions to to the same problem.
Thank you very much, Jose. Roberto, would you like a brief response or not? 1 minute.
The present situation is a good example, for instance. The appreciation of the dollar vis-a-vis the rest of the currencies has so far been very negative for the international trade, has not been a mechanism of adjustment. And particularly, the Fed has delayed the initiation of the rising of the interest rate, taking into account the situation of China and the rest of emerging market economy, and also probably some consideration of the European situation. But even has delayed for a while, has a commitment to start the rising this year. And even if you have delayed for a couple of months, the rising will be very inopportune for the rest of the world. And so Lawrence commented that there is no international mandate either in the European Central Bank or the Fed. Well, not only there is not any international mandate, but the Obama the Fed has been highly criticized by the Republicans for the swaps that helped to stabilize the domestic, the American financial system during the 2007-2008 the crisis. So I have highly criticized. How should we give money to foreign banks, they say, no? And so there is a system without without lender of last resort. And the only possible lender of last resort is the Fed. But because I like the idea that we can coordinate a Keynesian international currency. You know, but so far, if coordination is so difficult in the European market, imagine the difficulty of coordinating at the global level. You know?
Thank you, Roberto. Suppose you have a response to the questions and a final remark.
Why I was cautionary. I mean, this was, I guess, the, you know, more about making a bigger move from controls to liberalization, where you have to, you know, consider various aspects, and it's, you know, it's a somewhat different question to ask about this what were used in the last financial crisis by very specific some specific countries on putting up temporary controls, or which were meant for sort of relatively temporary controls to manage the, you know, the somewhat crisis situation. Those have been now tried and in some cases they clearly were useful. So this could be more way of the future. In some sense, we are in an intermediate situation now, which we think that mostly you don't try to control these movements, but if they start to get out of hand, then there are then there might be flexible, you know, new instruments where you might want to try them, to use them at the time. Sometimes, of course, it's then difficult to get out of these instruments. Sometimes it has worked fairly well. I mean, in Europe, we have two examples. Cyprus, which was, you know, which is somewhat very special, but still they introduced capital controls, got out of those controls fairly quickly. And then the other hand, Iceland, you know, much earlier, introduced them much earlier and is only now seeing if they can get out of this. It was over quite many years, in fact, in a crisis situation, which was thought to be more temporary than that. So these are, I mean, these experiences are very variable. So it's not panacea, but it's an understandable idea of having, especially in this, if, you know, things, situations become extreme, have try to have some new instruments, new tools, which hopefully are relatively temporary.
And of course, if you regulate your banking system in an open economy in terms of its currency exposure, you are in effect have a capital control system, yeah. Even though it's not called that. Lawrence, did you have any final thoughts?
Just very quickly. For Jerry, yes, indeed, Jerry, I fully agree that, you know, we do have the potential these days to be able to move towards greater attention to partially stabilizing real exchange rates. We can have some success. I would say we can have some success until the next crisis, next exchange rate crisis. And for Machiko, I was really grateful. Machiko and I have a perfect intellectual symbiotic relationship going back 40 years. So when I'm pessimistic, she's optimistic. And this is a wonderful example here where I said, please give us some optimism. And Machiko has given it to us with the view that actually we're at a conjuncture where it's in the interest of everybody to move for major reform. And therefore, we should be able to get it. I do remain pessimistic, though, Magico. So we'll carry on discussing.
Thank you, Lawrence. And Njuguna, would you like to close for us?
Yeah, just a final word. I think during crisis, that's when we start testing our policy position or even what we have been doing in practice. And most of the time we realize that we have been doing the wrong thing, so actually the policy has been wrong. For example, you find that during the global financial crisis, there's massive capital flight from some of the African countries, and currencies depreciated massively. But empirical regularity was that some countries that had some capital controls had actually more checked depreciations, but doesn't really tell us whether that is time to change policy. But you can see how all of a sudden we have abandoned the debate, but obviously that is what actually happened. But for me, at the end of it all, it's actually the African countries have to develop strong domestic financial markets. And strong domestic financial markets can only be developed using the route for perhaps integration, financial integration. And once they have strong institutions that preserve or protect the financial integration, we are going to have a clear-cut way of having some policy solutions within those slightly larger markets through integration. Of course, everybody talks about the East African community and looks at the European Union, what is really happening, but we actually argue that perhaps it's the institutions that we require to put in place, which have already been put in place, that are going to help that market in terms of moving in the direction that it wants. But of course, all these issues are quite pertinent and very important for a policy package. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, we'll close. I'd like to thank the speakers on your behalf and to thank them for their tolerance of my attempts to control their speaking times. Thank you very much.